Wow, I love that last song, Andy. I thought I was back in Kentucky. I'm telling you what, that it really did sound like that. I leaned over to Pastor Tommy. He said, "Do you feel at home?" Well, I've missed you all because I've not seen you since last decade. So happy New Year to you. Did you all make any resolutions? Any of y'all make some resolutions? Put your hands up if you did. I'm not going to put you on the spot, but yeah. Most people say that surveys show about 40% of Americans make at least one New Year's resolution. Now, of those who make resolutions, some stats that I saw this week say that 80% of them have fizzled out by February the 1st. And 55% of the resolutions we make have something to do with fitness or diet. In other words, it has something to do with your body. And that's pretty commonplace for us. Last year at Christmas, a wife gave her husband a seven-day experience where he got seven days by having his very own personal trainer at a local health club. This is what he said. He said, "I called and made reservations with someone named Tanya. She is a 26-year-old Pilates instructor and athletic clothing model. My wife seemed very pleased with how enthusiastic I was to get started. Day one, they suggested I keep this exercise diary to chart my progress this week. Started the morning at 6 a.m., tough to get up, but worth it when I arrived at the health club and Tanya was waiting for me. She's something of a goddess with blonde hair and a dazzling white smile. Tanya was very encouraging as I did my sit-ups, though my gut was already aching a little from holding it in the whole time I'd been talking to her. This is going to be great. Day two. Took a whole pot of coffee to get me out the door, but I made it. Tanya had me lie down on my back and push this heavy iron bar up in the air, and then she put weights on it. My legs were a little wobbly on the treadmill, but her smile made it all worth it. Muscles feel great. Day three, the only way I can brush my teeth is by laying the toothbrush on the counter and moving my mouth back and forth. Driving was okay as long as I didn't try to steer. Tanya was a little impatient with me and said that my screaming was bothering the other club members. Day four, Tanya was waiting for me with her vampire teeth in full snarl. I can't help it if I was half an hour late. It took me that long just to tie my shoes. I hid in the men's room until she sent Biff looking for me. Day five, I hate Tanya. I hate Tanya more than any human being has ever hated any other human being in the history of the world. If there was any part of my body not in extreme pain, I would hit her with it. She thought it would be a good idea to work on my triceps. I have news for you, Tanya. I don't have triceps. Day six, I got Tanya's message on my voicemail wondering where I am. I lacked the strength to use the TV remote control, so I watched 11 straight hours of the Weather Channel. Day seven, well, that's the week. Thank God it's over. Maybe next year my wife will give me something a little more fun, like a root canal or a kidney stone. Now, for significant change to take place in any aspect of our lives, it will always take discipline, resolve, and effort. And the start of the year always affords us the opportunity to try and assess where we are in a variety of areas and to take the steps necessary to improve. Now, there's nothing wrong with a resolution that has to do with your physical health. That's great. I made a couple of those this year myself. But the Bible does remind us that physical health is important. It says that our body is a temple of the Holy Spirit. But whether you are a longtime follower of Christ or you're relatively new to the faith, or maybe you are just checking out Christianity, or perhaps you're just someone who took a wrong turn and you followed the crowd into the parking lot. I don't know, but I want you to know, regardless of which category you fall into, I want to challenge you to set some spiritual goals, not just physical ones. And today we're going to use one verse that's going to kind of serve as a springboard, and then we're going to hop around and we're going to look at several different ones. So I want you to turn in your Bible, if you would, to Philippians chapter 3. You may have already turned there, but Philippians chapter 3, last week, a number of the campus pastors and different folks who preached at different campuses preached from this passage, Philippians 3, verses 7 through 14. I want to go back to verse 10, and we'll use verses 10 and 11 as our starting point. The Apostle Paul is writing, and he says, that I may know him, speaking of Jesus, and the power of his resurrection, and may share his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any possible means possible, that by any means possible, I may attain the resurrection from the dead. So there's the goal for us. You want to have a goal for your life. You want to have a goal for this year, for a decade, that I may know Christ. In order to know Christ, there are three directions that we are going to need to look. And that's what I want to talk about today. The first direction that we look is we want to look upward. That makes sense. You're in a church. Of course, we're going to talk about God and the role he plays in our lives. And so that's the starting point, is to look upward. Several years ago, I attended the National Day of Prayer service in Washington, D.C. And one of the most powerful moments for me was when Senate Chaplain Barry Black walked up to the podium. He took his Bible out and he began reading from Luke chapter 11, verse 1. And he read this. Now Jesus was praying in a certain place, and when he finished, one of his disciples said to him, Lord, teach us to pray as John taught his disciples. He finished reading that verse, he closed his Bible, he set it down, and he looked out at us, and he said this. He said, I find it interesting that when the disciples chose to ask for some advice from the Lord, they didn't ask him how to feed a multitude on a boy's lunch. They didn't ask him how to walk on water. They didn't ask him how to exorcise demons. Instead, they just said, Lord, teach us to pray. He said, evidently, there must have been some incredible correlation between his prayer life and the power he gained from it. Prayer is so important. If we're going to really look upward, it starts with growing in your prayer time. The same power that was available to the New Testament church when it comes through prayer is the same power that is available to us today in 2020. If you will take the time, if I will take the time to listen to God. And prayer can be the fuel that powers you, but you have to take the time to pray. It's a great way to start your day, or else it can easily get pushed to the side as each day has things calling for our attention. Yesterday, I was planning on praying to start my day, and then a phone call interrupted that, and then something else came up after that, and slowly it just got pushed to later and later until finally my prayers were probably a little bit more frantic. Later in the day before I preached. I'm not proud of that, but I'm just saying that sometimes the best things get pushed aside because of good things. Olin Hendricks talked about distractions, and he said the very essence of staying focused is the avoidance of distractions. The culprit is not the obvious, but the subtle. The diversions we most easily rationalize are the most dangerous. And so as Christians and as a church, we can't give in to those diversions and distractions. The good things that keep us from the best thing are the things that we need to make certain stay in their proper place and keep our focus. A lot of people will say, well, you know, Dave, I just don't know how to pray. I mean, I love the whole concept of prayer, but I don't know what to say. Well, prayer is simply a conversation between you and God. That's all it is. It's a conversation between two people who love each other. We invite his presence into our lives. And God does his best work when we pray. When we pray, we are inviting his influence and his power to come down and to take over a situation or a sickness or a predicament or a pain. We're also telling him how worthy he is to be praised. We're ascribing honor and homage to him. We're saying, you are the one and only. You are above all. You spoke the universe into existence. When I'm away from my wife, if I'm out of town and she doesn't happen to be with me, we text each other, we call each other. We have certain times when we call and we check in with one another. And when I get back home this afternoon, what's going to happen is I will fill her in on the things that have happened in my life, and I'll listen to the things that have happened in her life since we last spoke. That's what prayer is. You're telling God what is going on in your life. You're opening your heart to him. You say, doesn't he already know it? Yeah, you're not telling him for him. You're telling him for you. He already knows. He knows our thoughts. But there's something healthy about us going to him because we are acknowledging our dependence on him, our desperation for him. As we continue to look upward, we also want to grow in God's word. And that's so important. The Bible is so important to us. I want you to take your Bible out, and we're going to turn to Psalm chapter 1. If you don't know how to find the book of Psalms, here's what you do. You take your Bible like this, if you have an Old and New Testament, and you go to almost the halfway point. This all depends on how much stuff you have at the back. Let's see how we did. Psalm 51 is where I turn to, all right? So go back to Psalm chapter 1, and we're going to look at the opening verses of Psalms. David writes, "Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. The blessed individual avoids the distractions, and instead he delights in the law of the Lord." And we firmly believe that God inspired these words to be written by over 40 different authors, spanning over 15 centuries, and yet there is one common unwavering thread throughout all 66 different books. That thread is Jesus. And for those of you who are visiting, you may have seen people reading from a book, reading from the Bible when you came into the service today at any of our campuses. And if you're new to this, it might have been a little disorienting to you. You know, what's going on here? Well, we're reading our Bible to kind of prepare our hearts. We might look at what the text is going to be, and we read over it. This is a church that takes advantage of opportunities to dig deeper. There's a program at every Harvest campus. It's called Awana. It meets on Wednesday nights. It goes from 6:30 to 8 o'clock. It's for preschool through fifth graders. Awana is all about digging into God's word. Why is that so important? Well, let me just tell you, the majority of the verses that people know are ones that they learned years and years ago in those younger years, because you create this strong thread that is unbreakable. Because you learn those things when you're young, and they stay with you and they help you. That doesn't mean that those of us who are old don't get into that. No. We memorize God's word so that we'll be able to handle temptation. Flip over, stay in Psalms, but flip over to Psalm 119. It's the longest chapter in all of the Bible. Psalm 119, and take a look at verse 11. I just love this passage. Now, I love hearing those pages turn as well. Psalm 119, 11. David writes, "I have stored up your word in my heart that I might not sin against you." Knowing God's word helps you when you face temptation. It helps you conquer it. What did Jesus do in Matthew chapter 4 when he was tempted by Satan? Every time he was tempted, he answered him with the same three words. He started off by saying, "It is written." Because he knows there's strength in God's word. And let me say to you all at Harvest, from the bottom of my heart, that in the past number of months that I have been here, you all have taught me so much about the value and the importance of this book. You have, your staff has. And if you are new to Harvest, let me just acquaint you with this church. Harvest loves God's word. It always has. It always will. Harvest places a high premium and priority on biblical preaching. Harvest sees the Bible as a lamp unto our feet, as a light unto our path. This is not just any old book. A sovereign creator and God imparted these words. People have tried to eradicate the Bible. Diocletian was a Roman emperor during the 3rd century. He did everything he could to destroy the Bible. He had his henchmen collect every Bible, every single scribe that was out there that had written anything. He went to every one of their places, every scroll that was out there. He collected every one of them. He had this big giant bonfire, and he said that he had destroyed the Bible once and for all. But they didn't get them all. You see, the Jewish people have an incredible love for Scripture, and many of them hid the Bible. And when Constantine became the emperor, he became a Christian. and these different scrolls that had been hidden, and these things were pulled back out. And then he commissioned dozens of them to be written and to be made. Now, people think that they can destroy God's word. Nothing can destroy God's word. The word of the Lord endures forever. He tried to ban it. He tried to burn it. They scoff at it. They ridicule it. The grave has been dug for it 1,000 times, but the Bible never stays in the grave. Never. And I'm here to tell you that it can help you through the lowest moments of your life. Years ago, when I was about 6 years old, we were returning from a family vacation not real far from here. And the road was slick, and the sky was dark, and it happened in an instant. We were on a 2-lane highway, and the oncoming car maneuvered around the curve, but it hydroplaned, and it tried to overcorrect itself. And when the back end fishtailed, as it tried to correct itself, when it corrected itself, it was coming 60 miles per hour head-on right into our car. And these two station wagons smashed together. My dad was driving, wearing glasses at the time. His face struck the steering wheel. He had 21 shards of glass in his eyes. Behind him in the back seat, I was in the front seat. My mom was bleeding out from a life-threatening skull fracture. My brother was thrown all the way to the front. Head-on collision came with a sickening crash of shattering glass and crumpling steel. And after some initial chaos, as we just kind of settled in there, and my dad was incapacitated, my mom was dying in the back. After everything grew quiet, all I could hear was my dad's quivering voice, and this is what he said: "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." And he began quoting through the entire 23rd Psalm. In the distance, my brother and I heard the howl of sirens approaching through the rain, and above the wail of the ambulances, Dad just kept on quoting that scripture, and the verses just kept on coming. "Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me." And he walked all the way through that psalm. Still one of my most vivid memories of my entire childhood. This was no foxhole prayer. This was no panicked appeal in a time of crisis. It was just my dad's default setting. And quoting scripture was quite natural and normal for him, whether he was in the valley or whether he was on the mountaintop. My father knew that the Bible offers words that help and heal, words that can deepen joy and lessen sorrow. Praise the Lord that my mom was in ICU for 2 weeks, and she survived and continued to pour Christ into me and into our family. But I will never forget that day, because in that traumatic moment, what my dad was modeling for his sons without even knowing it was the importance of God's word. When the unexpected sirens of life come your way, what will be the first words that come out of your mouth? If you're going to have a 2020 vision in 2020, then we shouldn't just look upward. We also need to look outward. In this self-centered society, we need to take the spotlight off of ourselves, and we need to place it on those that are around us. That's where our attention needs to be. We need to look more for those windows of opportunity to serve others, to share Christ, to encourage them. We should be in 2020 looking for more windows than mirrors, and that goes totally against our society. Now, one way that we look outward is that we grow in our worship. So write that down if you're taking notes. We want to grow in our worship. We're giving him the glory and praise that is due him. He deserves it. He is all powerful. So decide right now on the first weekend of January that you will be at worship service each week, that you will make it a priority, that it's really not up for discussion. The weather does not dictate what you do. What you did the night before and how late you stayed out does not dictate that. You wouldn't use that to keep you away from work, so why use it to keep you away from worship? And there are reasons that we think weekly worship is so important. One of the reasons is because Jesus taught us that example in Luke chapter 4, verse 16. It says that he went to the synagogue each week on the Sabbath, as was his custom. Make this a custom. Make this a healthy habit for you. Parents, your kids will benefit from this rather than saying, you know, are we going to church today? Are we going to church today? Of course we're going to church this weekend. We want to worship the Lord. Turning your Bible all the way back to the very first book of the Bible. So it's easy to find Genesis. We go all the way back to the very beginning. I want you to turn to Genesis chapter 22. Genesis 22. This is where the very first mention of the word worship occurs. And the setting is Abraham. God has told him to go sacrifice his one and only son. This is foreshadowing of the of what's going to happen in the New Testament with Jesus. And he says, I want you to sacrifice this son. He doesn't tell his wife what he's going to do. They make a journey. They go to Mount Moriah. And as they get ready to go up this mountain, I want you to see what it is that Abraham says. Genesis 22, verse 5. Then Abraham said to his young men, hey, stay here with the donkey. I and the boy will go over there and worship and come again to you. When Abraham went up to worship, he didn't think he would have much to worship about. I mean, think about it. Who celebrates the death of his own son? No doubt he probably didn't feel like worshiping. He was just there out of obedience. But when God saw his commitment level, he spared the life of Abraham's son, and everything changed. And what Abraham thought would be anything but worship must have broken out into the most spectacular worship that Abraham had ever experienced. But there's a lesson in this. This is the first mention of worship. What does that tell us? Worship always costs us something. It always costs us something. And when you come to worship, you don't come to get. You don't come to receive. It's not all about you. You come to give. You come to give to a holy God. You give him your time. You give him your energy. You give him your resources. Some of you have even given up some ties with some family, friends, or with some others that are close to you. But you come in and you give something. That's the mindset you have. It's not what's in it for me. I can get an escape from the rat race of life, or I can make some new friends, or I can get some new clients through my networking at church events. No, when you come into church, it's about what you can give to God. That's true worship. Some choose to stay away from church because they don't want to feel uncomfortable if they hear something which points out the duplicity in their life. So rather than come and put themselves under Scripture, instead, they choose to stay away from it, and they come up with all sorts of excuses because they don't want to put themselves in a situation where the Holy Spirit can convict them of some sin and steer them toward repentance and making healthy choices. And so instead, they just stop coming. And that way they think, well, I won't have to deal with it. Ah, but they're wrong. They're wrong. You will have to deal with it. They have to deal with it months later when that marriage that meant so much to them has evaporated. They have to deal with it when their boss pulls him or her aside and says, you know what, you know why you're being demoted. It's because alcohol has totally taken over your life and you don't have that in check and it's affecting your job performance. You see, when you come to church, there is fellowship that takes place, but there is also accountability that takes place. Your spiritual life can begin to fade out when you separate yourself from the body of Christ. We worship Christ for fellowship. We come to God's house because of what it is that we can do for God in ascribing to him what is worthy as the creator, as our sustainer, as our redeemer. There's a passage of Scripture in Hebrews chapter 10. Verse 25, it says this. It says, not neglecting to meet together as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near to you. What's the approaching day he's talking about? He's talking about the second coming of Jesus Christ. And so when we come together because there should be a sense of urgency and because we want to make certain that people are prepared for when Jesus does return. So if you want to grow outward, then you grow in your worship, but you also, secondly, grow in your involvement at Harvest. Find ways to get plugged in, to serve, to encourage, to give generously. The start of the year is a great time for you to set up your online giving or to adjust it. Let's say if you've gotten a raise for 2020, then that's a time to reflect that and to adjust that on your online giving. I set up my online giving at Harvest a number of months ago. I am technologically challenged. I am terrible, you know. If my computer, it says you performed an illegal operation, I called the police and said, I'm sorry. You know, I don't understand the process. So I'm just telling you, you can set up online giving in like 3 minutes time. And it's an opportunity for you to give of the first fruits of what you've had in a disciplined and consistent way. Even back in the Old Testament, God included worship in the Ten Commandments when he said, remember the Sabbath and keep it holy. And sometimes that Sabbath would be observed out of joy and celebration and thanksgiving. Other times, I think worship, you come into worship and you're here more because it's a healthy habit. And you kind of are here out of duty. And I understand that. It's that way for the preacher at times too. But when we show up, God does something. God promises to show up. Maybe you heard about the mom that was at the bottom of the stairs at her house, and she hollered up to her son and said, this is the last time I'm going to tell you. Get out of bed. Get your church clothes on. We're going to church. And he said, I don't want to go. I don't want to go. You get out of bed and you go do it. He said, there's two reasons I don't want to go. He said, the people are mean and the sermons are boring. She said, I'll give you two reasons that you need to get up. He said, number one, you're 40 years old. Number two, you're the pastor. So I know that sometimes you will be here at Harvest simply out of a sense of duty. I understand that. But those are the times when unexpectedly God shows up in ways through a testimony, through someone that you talk with in the lobby, through a chance encounter with someone that you had no idea had started coming to Harvest, through a baptism that you witness, through a lyric of a song that is sung, through a scripture that is read. And God shows up in your life and you're like, oh, I'm so glad I didn't miss that. Worship has a way of disturbing those who are comfortable and comforting those who are disturbed. It may be due to depression or divorce or death or a downsizing or a displacement due to debt. But regardless of the cause, worship puts a salve on those open wounds and can begin the healing process. This is what Dietrich Bonhoeffer says. He says, the church is only church when it exists for others. And he's right. The church has to be outward focused. We're not just supposed to take care of the needs of those who are within. Church is the only organization that exists for those people who are not yet there. That's who Christ wants us to reach. And the New Testament church in the book of Acts was constantly reaching out to others and inviting them to check out the Christ of the cross. So this year, decide you're going to bring your unchurched friends. You're going to invite your coworkers, and you're going to scatter those seeds indiscriminately. You're going to push those boundaries out so that others can be allowed in. Well, to have that perfect vision, that 2020 vision, there's one more direction we need to look. We look upward, we look outward, and of course the last one is we look inward. And this is sobering at times because it's always easier to identify character flaws and moral miscues and poor judgment in the lives of others. And we can always remain kind of oblivious and blind to our own weaknesses. But the Apostle Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 5, he says, examine yourselves to see whether you are in the faith. Test yourselves. So he says, examine yourself. And a big part of the Christian life is doing a personal inventory and seeing how it is that you're doing. And what better time to do that than at the first of the year? How am I doing at pouring into others? If I'm a Christian, how am I doing at pouring into others? If I'm a Christian, how am I doing at sharing my faith with others? Am I colliding the two groups of my Christian friends and my non-Christian friends? Every one of us desperately needs what a healthy, Bible-believing, Spirit-led church can provide. Every one of us. But it's easy for Christians and churches to fixate on the storms, to fixate on the negative, to get locked into the problems that we experience and those things that we've gone through. I got to thinking about something this past week. I was driving in my car, and something just hit me. I realized there's two places that you can look while you're driving. There's a rearview mirror, and there's your windshield. Now, one is much bigger than the other and affords you ample views, almost 180 degrees. It gives you a wide variety, and you can see where you want to head into the future. That's your windshield. But your eyes have another possible choice, and that is they can fixate on the rearview mirror. It's much smaller, and by adjusting it, it allows you to see what's behind you. It allows you to see what's in the past that you've just gone past. And that's fine as long as the rearview mirror is used for what it's designed for, and that is to glance at, to get some idea of what is going on behind you. But don't dwell on it. This week I got a tape measure out, and I went out and I measured my windshield and got the dimensions of it, and then I measured my rearview mirror. And I'm not real good at math, but I was able to determine this, that my windshield is 86 times the size of my rearview mirror. And there's a reason for that. If I'm really driving into the future and not going back in the past, I'm going to need something that big. Now, both are necessary and both serve a purpose. Both can improve our vision, but can I tell you something? If your focus is on what lies behind you instead of what lies before you, you will run the risk of having an accident. There's a reason it's 1/86th of the other. And the greatest benefit in your driving and in your life comes when you keep your focus on what's in front of you. And the same is true with the church, especially with this church. And as we have painfully tried to put the disorientation and the disappointment and the chaos and the confusion and the pain of the past, as we've tried to put it in the rearview mirror, Satan has been very quick to constantly try to bring what's in the rearview mirror and put it all front and center and cover our windshield with it. He wants it, our past, to be as large as the windshield, but it's not. Now, the rearview mirror serves a purpose for the church. Don't get me wrong, there is a great benefit to glancing in the rearview mirror and looking at the past. But what I'm saying is we learn from the past, we don't live in the past. And that's where we're at right now. If you are preoccupied with the past, that means in the present you will operate out of fear rather than faith. And we don't want to do that. We want to say to our faithful God in 2020, where would you have us go? What would you have us do? And then we want to boldly follow where he leads us and do what he tells us. A little bit later in this service, you're going to hear from Greg Bradshaw. Greg is our lead ministry pastor. If you know Greg at all, you know Greg leads so well. You know why he leads so well? Because he leads out of his personal relationship with Jesus Christ. And he's a man of integrity, and he's a man of conviction. And that's why it's so easy for us to follow him. And he'll be sharing for a few minutes later on in the service about what's going to take place this next month and as we kind of get excited about this whole year. And after this next series that we're going to have, we hope that we can just say with the Apostle Paul, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on. Amen. That's what we want to do. And what happens is when we set goals and we determine our direction, when we say, God, I want to know Christ, that's what drives me. I want to know Christ. When we say that, it's unbelievable what God can do. Now, I mentioned earlier that 80% of New Year's resolutions fizzle out by February 1st. I've got a question for you. What if rather than making a New Year's resolution, instead you chose one word to inspire and guide your decisions in 2020? Now, the motivation for that idea came to me when I was sitting at the Elgin campus back in November, and I was watching the baptism of a couple, Tim and Ashley Quinlan, and they both shared very succinctly their spiritual journey. They'd been coming to Harvest for about a year, and they just talked from their heart. And I loved what Ashley said as she was talking. She said, well, I picked as my intent word for the year the word surrender. And she said, because I just wanted it to be his will and not my will. And I have this tendency to want to take control of everything. And I talked with Tim and Ashley to get their permission about sharing this. But Ashley said that that idea came from a girlfriend of hers last year. And she said, pick a word that will help you work on your walk with the Lord. And so Ashley said, I picked one word that would serve as a guide, and I could just focus on that word. She said, I even had it inscribed and put on a bracelet, and I wear it every day, and sometimes I just glance down at it, and I see surrender. And it just reminds me that if I'm going to be the wife I'm supposed to be, if I'm going to be the godly woman God wants me to be, then I have to give him control and just surrender it to him. And what she shared motivated me to challenge all of us to say, perhaps we should each choose a word instead of making a resolution. You see, Mike Ashcroft put it well when he wrote a book a number of years ago called My One Word. He contends that New Year's resolutions seldom work because they are based on something we're tired of being, rearview mirror, rather than focusing on our potential and who we can become, windshield. And that's what we need to do. My New Year's exercise or assignment for all of us is to take some time and to pray and to seek God's face in the next couple of days and to write down some different words or themes that could help motivate and inspire you to humble yourself and become the person that God wants you to become. Let me just try to spur your thinking. You don't have to use any of these words. Let me just try to spur your thinking and give you some possible words. And maybe something that I say will kind of help you. Words like grateful or giver or self-controlled, or maybe your word's going to be focused or trust. Perhaps it's going to be content. Maybe it's thirsty or hungry or disciplined or present. You just need to be there in the moment. Maybe your word's going to be intentional. My wife for this year, she chose the word increase. Why'd she choose that? She wants her faith and her trust in God to increase to new highs. My word a few years ago was pursue. My wife's word back a few years ago was trust. Maybe your word will be expectant. Maybe it's going to be hopeful. God wants hopeful to be the word for you. Maybe you want to be on a path of deepening, and your word might be something like grow or abide or stretch. Maybe you're trying to put the past behind you, and your words need to be words like forgiven or holy or content or purity or discipline. I don't know what your word needs to be. Maybe you'll choose the word upward. Maybe you'll choose outward. It's not a resolution. It's more of a path. It's one word, and when you land on it, whether it's today, whether it's later this week, I'm going to challenge you to do something. I want you to share that word with others. I want you to tell others what your word is. For those of you who are on some type of social media, you know, I'm on Instagram. Post a picture of that word that you have just in front of you, or just put it there on your Instagram and tag some other people in the church on it so that they'll see it, or tag Harvest Bible Chapel on there. And you know what will happen? Your friends will say, hey, what was the deal with that word? What was going on with that? And it will give you an opportunity to be a positive witness, an outward testimony, and conversations will start out of that. It will also add a layer of accountability with your Christian friends. In 2020, we want to live a life that communicates, I want to know Jesus Christ. That's what we want. I'm going to ask you to bow your heads, and I'm going to give you, every campus, just bow your head. I'm going to give you about 15 or 20 seconds just of silence. I just want you to ponder what words God might be laying on your heart right now. Just take a second and listen. Father in heaven, we know that there is only one name that we want to focus on. That's the name of Jesus. It's the only way salvation can come our direction. But we're asking you to kind of guide us in this search and this journey for one word that might be very defining in our lives. Lord, it's our prayer that you'll lead us to that word, that it will be a word that exalts and honors you, that perhaps reveals something and shows some vulnerability that we're working on and that we can only conquer or achieve through the power of your Holy Spirit. So Lord, will you direct our thoughts? Will you direct us to that one word? And more importantly than any word, will you help us to live a life that exemplifies, I want to know Jesus. It's in his name we pray. Amen.